is a man who is more than likely the head of the Sanhedrin. And to be head of the Sanhedrin, the rabbinic council, he would have had to have been a very devout man. And the standards of what devotion to Father would have been at that time, this really goes way beyond anything that we have as an example today in this postmodern, post everybody doing it their own way and a few other titles that I could put in there. And Jesus looked at this man, his name was Nicodemus. More than likely, Nicodemus was a Pharisee, which would be of the Haredi, which would be basically classified as ultra-Orthodox. He would have started learning the Word of God and be able to quote the Word of God. By the time he would have been able to quote at least the entire Torah, which would be the five books of Moses, but usually it went beyond that because it was very good intellects. Father gave his people very good minds, very good memory. By the time he would have his bar mitzvah. So by 4 years old he started, and by the age of 12, 13 years old, he would have been a pretty much, by all modern classification, a master of the Bible, a master of the Word of God. And then he would have spent his life completely devoted every day to being in the tabernacle, to being in the temple, to honoring the Lord, to walking in all the mitzvot, or the things to observe God's ordinances and statutes and commands. It was possible. He would have been easily classified in the same category that Zechariah and Elizabeth would have been classified in when the Lord came to Zechariah and Elizabeth and called them righteous, found them without fault, blameless before him. You know, Paul said concerning the law, I was blameless in the keeping of the law and the dedication of his consecration to the things of the law. It was his whole life. Everything he did. I mean, he lived his life pursuing an acceptance with God. He lived his life pursuing a righteousness and a purity that would somehow be recognized by God as acceptable enough to be able to come a little bit closer. Because it was really very clearly made known to Israel that the holies of holies is different from everywhere else, and the only person that can come in here is the one that I anoint and the one that I give the grace and the ability to come in. And so all Israel knew and understood the holiness of God being something that was classified him as separate and unique from all the rest of the world. And that is the definition of holiness. It defines who God is, separate from all humanity. And Jesus looks at Nicodemus, and Nicodemus, obviously, some of the things that we can tell about Nicodemus is he wasn't just a religious man. You can't classify him, though he is the head of the Pharisee or the Haredi, which is the ultra-Orthodox. Pharisee, by the way, means those who are separated unto God. It's the separated ones. It was really, you could call it a group of consecrates that was started by Ezra. Ezra was radical. Ezra came back into the Reformation of Israel. And he said, all of you have taken foreign wives, foreign husbands. Tell them to leave now. Your children, everybody, out now. The Reformation of Israel in 1948 doesn't look anything like what happened in the Reformation and the returning of Israel and Ezra. Israel does not even want to be a religious state. They want to be a secular state. The ideas and the notions that overdramatic Western Christians have of Israel is completely a farce. It doesn't have any reflection of reality. Israel does not want the temple built, 70% plus. because that means according to Maimonides and according to the order of Ezra, that means that a king has to be put into place, the Sanhedrin has to rule, and the Amalek has to be removed, and the Amalek would be all Gentiles. And that just isn't going to happen. Not now. There's going to be lots of changes before that's ever going to happen. Most Israelis, if you ask most Israelis, if they talk, you talk to most Israelis about Jerusalem and the temple being built, they go, look, we don't want to be Iran. Iran is a religious state. We'll be secular. And that's really the way they look at it. And it's so sad because we try to measure our personal and current experience with the things with the Word of God, and unfortunately, it doesn't even come close. Now, that is sad. And I'm going to talk to you about why that's so sad in a minute, and a remedy and a solution for that. But you've got Nicodemus. He's not like any other Pharisee. He's not like any other separated one. He's not like any other Haredi. The Haredi are those. Haredi means to tremble at the word of God. Haredi is ultimately a word that was phrased for all ultra-Orthodox in every category of ultra-Orthodox of Jews today. And why we know that is because he had a sensitivity towards the Lord, and he comes to the Lord by night and he says, Master, Rabbi, Rabbi says, I know that you're from God. It's because there's no way that you could do what you did unless God's with you. Jesus immediately turns to him and says, thank you. I really appreciate that. I needed some encouragement today. And we just started a church downtown Jerusalem, and we're just really believing that God's going to bless it. And, you know, we'd like for you to consider being a part of it. Come as you are. He didn't say that. That may be what we would say today, but he didn't say that. He came right to the point and he said, I'm going to tell you something. The way you are is not acceptable to God. See, when I think about Paul on the road to Damascus, he was pursuing righteousness with God. But he suddenly discovered the revelation of righteousness given to him as a gift. All of a sudden, the righteousness of God did not become a substitute of some existential, positional imputation created by some theological concept of men. It became the moment of coming home. It became the moment of attainment. It became the moment of arrival. All of a sudden, he encountered the righteousness of God, which was without the law. No need for mitzvot anymore. It was his. There was the idea and the notion that somehow he was not going to continue on in God's judgments and God's ways. Well, that would be absolutely ridiculous. I just came into the realm of now being able to do this. I just now experienced the new covenant, which now Nicodemus knows exactly what Jesus is talking about, even though that the goyim today doesn't, even though that people standing in the church today, even that a redeemed doesn't understand. He knew he was declaring what Jeremiah said. He knew he was declaring what Ezekiel said. A new heart will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. He understood that Father would give us a new heart and cause us to be able to walk in his ways and keep his statutes and keep his judgments now by nature. You don't understand that. Most people don't understand that. They often some la-la land, crazy theology that Jesus Christ coins heresy. That God the Holy Ghost says doesn't even exist in the creation of those things which I've made and planned. He looks at Nicodemus and he said, you cannot understand or know or enter into the kingdom of God until you're born again. You've got to be born from above. An event where he becomes not of this world, even as God is not of this world. where God writes upon his heart and upon his mind his statutes and his ways and his laws so that he would be able to do them, and all idolatry and all uncleanness and the perpetual spiritual uncleanness would be forever removed out of the heart of Israel. And that he would open up the door and allow the Gentiles to come in, the nations, and participate with the covenant. And then Jesus goes and gives another revelation after making this known to Nicodemus that he could be born of the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit. After making known to him that he could be born of the Holy Ghost, which is a radical, millennial heaven concept to the mind of any person who understands the Word of God, especially in the context of Nicodemus' thinking, it was almost more than could be imagined. To be born from above. To actually be at that moment in time where all spiritual iniquity, all idolatry, all otherness would be purified out of the heart and midst of Israel, and the people would become one with God. They knew it, they understood it about an age that would come, a heavenly age that would come when the Messiah would come, set up his kingdom upon the earth, and God would come. And he would dwell in the midst of them. And all the unclean things would be purged out of them. They would never again turn back to idolatry or turn back to wickedness. For the Lord would have utterly removed sin out of the earth. And they knew all those prophecies. You may not know that I just quoted a whole bunch of verses of scripture, but Nicodemus knew it. Most people, they come and they sit and they listen to people like me preach. They have no idea. That all they think I'm just touting philosophy. I have no idea. All I'm doing, weaving together verses of scripture. That if you have the ability, because you've given yourself to seeking after God, well, no, wow, that's the Word of God. I mean, I've had people tell me, you know, all you did was quote the Word of God. I don't agree with it, but you did just quote the Word of God. Because people, and that's real easy for men, because they want to fashion it according to a philosophical notion, and it's nothing new. That's just the way it is. Back in the days, because Constantine ultimately lost his control and his power in the Roman Empire. And he saw the waning of the Roman Empire. He looked around. He was, after all, he was married to his mother. Just after his forefathers and the gods that he served, as Nimrod was married to his mother. And it was a long line of it, because the thing about it was, if they were going to hook up with their gods, they needed to imitate their gods. Now, this is the way it was. And so what he did was he goes and he grabs a hold of, he bypasses the church at Antioch, because they're going to see through him and they're going to short him out, and they're going to say, just like Peter said, you know, to Simon the sorcerer, you're in the bondage of bitterness, you know. You're under the power of the devil. He went and jumped right over to Alexandria, where all the philosophers were, the Neoplatonists were. And he said, guys, I want you to come help me. We're going to start ourselves a kingdom. They became our church fathers, Justin Martyr, Tatian, Clement of Alexander. The list goes on. Origen, Eusebius, Jerome. And they believed that none of the scripture could be understood for what it is. It had to be understood by the teachings of Aristotle. Now, the teachings of Aristotle is the means by which Alexander the Great became so demon-possessed. This is just the way it works. This isn't my idea of it. I'm not putting a spin on history. Alexander the Great sat at Aristotle's feet to learn how to be demon-possessed. And these are those students of Aristotle and Socrates and Plato. Philo, who was a Jewish philosopher, who was also the one who took so much of Judaism and married it with Greek philosophy, and now I see all these churches and even supposed messianic Jews following not Neoplatonism, but Neophiloism. And I'm like, that's not the tradition. And they don't have the ability to even look. First of all, they've never spent the time studying. They just basically went from one tradition to another. This basically, the students of men, they never looked at where's the foundation of this? Where does this all come from? Well, why am I saying five cups of Passover? Where on earth does that come from? I mean, and the list goes on. I don't want to go into all of it. I'm just trying to make a point of how that ultimately the Word of God got hijacked by philosophy. And when Paul said, watch out, you're going to be spoiled through traditions and philosophies that make you and fashion you after the Word instead of fashioning you after Jesus Christ. And the world is caught up in it, and all I am is one voice against all these others because people are so impressed by numbers. They're so impressed by what popular opinion suggests and what people say on CNN. And I'm telling you right now, people, and you are part of people, move with the mass of humanity. You don't move necessarily with the Holy Ghost and want to help me with that. Because God's Word hasn't changed. And the reality of the plenary of the Scripture is easily viewed, whether it's understood or not. It's there for everybody to read. It's there for everybody to agree with or disagree with. But I'm going to tell you what happened. The evilness that took place in the 3rd and 4th century demanded all Scripture be understood through the roads of the philosophers. Clement of Alexander, who most people call one of our great church fathers, this is what he said, I quote it. And you could probably, the way the internet is, you could probably even Google this and find this quote. He says, the Word of God by itself is of very little value. It must be understood through the robe of the philosopher. And what he said, and what he meant by the robe of the philosopher, that was a way to say, by those of us who have received our doctorate degree and the way that the world really works. So that we can really help you understand this is all mystical, it is all spiritual, and now we alone have the power and the ability to interpret it, and it was held in the empire of the Roman Catholic Church until 1967, 1968. That time the Roman Catholic Church was losing so many people to the Jesus movement, then by 1970 to the Charismatic movement, they said, okay, you guys can read the Bible now too, but you won't understand anything you're saying. You're reading. So just come to us and we'll interpret it for you. And then you ask, how much of that exists in Protestantism? About 80% of Protestantism is infected like a virus from hell with the same philosophical ideology. Now you can go ahead and be seated now that you know that. And we'll just talk to you. I'm going to tell you, God demands that you are completely and 100% different than the way you were born. God demands that you become completely and totally different than the way all the world is and all humanity runs in this course of iniquity and sin. You listen to me, because I'm telling you exactly what the Word of God describes. I'm telling you. This door is open to anyone. It doesn't matter who, what denomination you're from, or whether you're from a denomination at all, whether you're a heathen or whether you're a Jew or a Gentile, whether you're a Scythian or who you are, what your ancestry is. God has made a way for anybody who's willing to be completely transformed and changed by His glorious power and to become different. Now listen to me, all of you that are just high on yourself. You are born in sin and you were shaped in iniquity. You were born in sin, and because you were born in sin, you were born under the control and the authority of the powers of darkness. Every day of your life, under that pseudo-sovereignty of Satan, you were shaped and fashioned to think like he thinks, to react like he reacts, and to live to some measure or degree as he lives, based upon whatever boundary of morality that existed within your culture and how that culture defined that morality, and then basically prosecuted that morality. And that prosecution of the morality is about if you do something wrong, you're going to go to jail. You understand? If you're born in the jungles of Papua New Guinea and different parts of, especially in Irian Jaya, it's okay to be a cannibal and go hunt heads. Here you can't hunt people's heads and eat their bodies. They have a different morality. They have a different way of processing and thinking. Hello. You have a different morality. Okay? Instead of lusting after somebody's bottom end, they're lusting after the elbow because it's a soup bone. Are you listening to me? And both are gross. Is the bottom line of it is both is gross because reality is men have reduced the life of God to nothing more than something that is purely animalistic about reproduction and eating and food and whatever else. Nonsense. And about how you can dress up and make yourself look better. I'm going to tell you, listen, you know, I've spent many, many hours of my life studying the things in a history of humanity that clearly show how demon spirits taught men how to sin. People don't realize this, but a demon spirit taught Adam how to sin. A demon spirit came into the garden and taught Eve, Hava, and Adam how to sin, how to disobey. And it continued to grow. And the interaction of the devil and his angels grew to such a point of them being able to interact and teach men how to sin that in less than 1,656 years, man became so wicked that God said, I repent that I've even made them. That's what he said. Now, maybe you are listening here in this place today or watching by web or on YouTube, and you don't realize that the things that I'm saying is exactly the Word of God. I'm not adding anything to it. I'm not taking away anything. I'm not putting my spin on it. It's not understood through philosophical ideology. Just the Word of God. And Genesis chapter 6, in the first few verses there, show you that God said, I repent that I've even made man. The imagination of his heart is wicked continually, verse 5. Okay? And so what did he do? You want to see the love of God manifested? Here's the love of God manifested. I'm not having sin and iniquity in my world. People think that God's got to accept whatever it is that they're dishing out. I'm going to tell you right now, if God was to accept what man's dishing out, then heaven would be hell. Because what makes hell, hell is sin. What makes the earth less than heaven right now is sin. What's messed up your life is sin. And Christ Jesus came to save sinners. He came to deliver them. He bore our sins on the cross so that there would be a doorway of escape opened up so we could escape every form of sin and iniquity and come live over in this glory realm with him. People, you live in a society that was shaped by demon spirits. You live in a culture that was shaped by demon spirits. Now, there has been a certain amount of morality, once again, that has been, as it were, a stopping point for what Satan would do if he had no hindrances. And praise God that much of what America, in the society of America, was based off of, was based off of the Bible. My grandmother was a school teacher on the prairie, and on back through till early 1600s, my ancestors here were involved in both church and in school. That's basically how it went. And the textbook was the Bible. It was the Bible. You learned history from the Bible, and then if you could afford it, the community could afford it, you get a couple other little, you know, additional history books about Western civilization as it was understood then. And so therefore, our culture, in fact, most people don't even know this, but the first government of the United States of America was the Boston, the Massachusetts Boston House of Commons. And it was run by preachers, and it was run by the church. And it wasn't good. It could have been good, but it wasn't good, because they were evil men, by and large. You know, with respect to their bias. They were righteous and holy men with respect to most of your churches today. But if you didn't agree with them on their doctrinal interpretation of Scripture, you would become an outcast. And as one of my relatives, you'd get hung. So they would hang me, no question. That's why it wasn't good. I'd be hung. I wouldn't be allowed to preach the way I'm preaching, move the way I'm moving. And so praise God that got moved out of the way.
It's the wrong kind of restraint, taking things in the wrong direction. You got to believe what I believe rather than believing what the Bible believes. I mean, they were persecuted, and they came to the United States of America because they were persecuted. Huh? It's like, you know, Cade, my son now, his parents, his great-grandparents persecuted my great-grandparents because they were the Puritans and we were the Quakers. And that's the way it went down. They left persecution to come persecute each other, you know, basically. But the beautiful thing of it is, is much of our culture and most of who we are as Americans, as people, as citizens of the United States of America, we had for our Constitution and we had for our laws and the administration of our government, both federally and and based on the states, was really about the Word of God. I mean, I'm telling you right now, back in 1960, in most states in the United States of America, clearly by the 50s, in most states in the United States of America, you could be prosecuted for committing fornication and for committing adultery, still be prosecuted. We come a long way, baby. Yeah, you just more like the devil than you were before. That's all. Just more restraints have been removed. As you remove the restraints of the law and the restriction of morality wherever you can find it, all Satan's going to do is he's going to have more room to take you into a greater realm of iniquity so that you can participate with more of that which he's doing. And that will ultimately be realized in what we call the tribulation, and we read about how God's wrath is going to be poured out upon men because of their sin and because of their iniquity, and he's going to say that sin can't get any worse. In other words, he likens sin into grapes, and he says the grapes are of wrath are fully ripe, and I'm going to go stomp some grapes right now. And so he comes with his garments dipped in blood, because he is going to annihilate, do away with, destroy with the rod of his mouth and by the authority of his power every sin and every iniquity. And people don't believe this. They say, we're all going to sin more or less every day. We all live in the world. God says you're not supposed to live in the world, and you're not supposed to sin more or less every day. He said, I came and I delivered you. I gave you a new heart. I gave you a new spirit. And then he takes it beyond what I just read to you in Nicodemus, and he says, wait a minute. Not only will you be born again, not only will you become a new creation, not only will you become a new creature, not only will you now come into the righteousness of God, not the righteousness of the law, not the righteousness of men, but the very righteousness which God himself possesses, but I'm going to pour out my Holy Spirit, my spirit of holiness upon you, my spirit of obedience upon you. And out of your life will flow forth rivers of expression of his own person and nature. Well, that is not anything like what's being believed in the church. No, we got to spin. Let me get my doctorate degree out here. Let me get all the stuff I learned from Aristotle and everything I learned from Socrates and Philo and from the rest of the devils and tell you what that means. And take all the power out of it and all the potency out of it and all the oneness with God and make you transcendent other. Huh? People, I'm telling you right now, it's about time. God's calling people to come and do what he very clearly says in his word. And if you do not have the experience of the word, you don't have the experience that God's purpose for you to have. And all you got to do is get real with God, and he'll give you the experience of his word. Somebody said, don't tell people the truth because you're going to shake their fragile faith. I'm like, what faith? If what I'm going to say, if the truth is going to shake their fragile faith, they have none. They just as much on their way to an eternity without God as any other person that is lost, as any Hindu, as any Muslim, as any Jew, as any person who has not been transformed by the power of God. It's not just some Pentecostal Protestant or Catholic genuflex. It's a transformation and a change of your life and of your nature, where the power of God comes and moves in, and your body's not your own anymore. It becomes a temple of the Holy Ghost. Somebody said we can all serve God when we lose our sex organs. That's what Aristotle said. And virtue was homosexuality. Forgive me for my plainness of speech, but I'm not going to, not really. Because right now, it is so, the iniquity, the door of iniquity has been so open that kindergartners are sharing pornography in their school. And they have no idea, they don't even have the physiological responses and understanding and concept to deal with it, but because it's cool. They're defining themselves as whether they're bisexual, homosexual, or heterosexual. You know, people, my dad's generation can't even imagine that this could even be talked about, because you never even said this, talked about this among adults, and kids are having to deal with this, and they're just having a big lawsuit because some six-year-old decided that they wanted to be a girl, and everybody in the classroom knew they were a boy, and now they're being persecuted because they're a girl. They're having a hard time changing, calling him Jane when he was Joe. He's 6 years old.
We removed the restraint, you see.
And the more that you understand these things, the more that you begin to understand how that you are just assimilated into the system of your society and of your world that you live in, and the culture that is imposed upon you by the sociology that you've agreed with. Are you going to come out from among them? You're going to be separate, says God, and I will receive you, and I will be your God, and you'll be my people. Because everything that belongs to the world, all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eye, and the pride of life, it's not of me, has nothing to do with me. I'm opposed to it. Anybody who's friend with the world and anybody who's caught up in worldliness is my enemy. That's the scripture. God called us into holiness, which by definition is sanctification. It's to be consecrated. It's to be consecrated. Consecrated to what? His ways, kind of his ways, a modification of his ways, a 2016 interpretation of his ways, or his ways as he is who he is by nature, who he's always been eternally and will not change, and has made a way where you and I could be so a part of him and so integrated with him that he calls us one and says, I'm in you. He says, if you abide in me and my word abides in you, he gives us an opportunity to come and abide in him. It's the call of salvation to come and live and dwell and have all of our consciousness and all of our ideas and all of our position and appetite and emotion in him. And then he goes on to say, and the greater one, Christ Jesus, is also on the inside of you. And this is the gospel that we teach, that we may present every man perfect and complete before the Lord. Christ is in you. And you, so you're supposed to not believe every spirit, but you're supposed to try the spirits. Because many false prophets have gone out into the world. And every spirit that does not confess that Jesus has come in the flesh and that he also dwells inside of us is not of God. See, the reality of it is people supposedly went and were born again and got saved and gave their life to Jesus, but they never received the life of Jesus. They never received the life of the Spirit. They never received the life of God. They live by the older life, the former life. They live by the life of human existence where you were born in sin and shaped in iniquity, every day taught to be just like the devil. God gives us an opportunity and a call to be born in righteousness and born in true holiness. And so Paul says in this born again experience, he says, you're a new creation. You're a new creature. Everything old is gone. Everything new has come. Everything now is of God. He says in this new creation, in this new creature experience, he said now you've been renewed. You've been reshaped. You've been recreated in righteousness and true holiness, just like God. And I'm probably one of the few people on the planet that's even bringing these verses of scripture up today. And at the transition of 2015 and 2016. And saying, this is the born again experience, and anything other than this is not of God. It's not what God created. It's not what Jesus brought to pass. It's not the new birth experience. And now, they're trying to make laws against people like me. So that I can't say, you're wrong. You're participating with a demonic power. But I will say it.
Amen.
With no problem. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Because God's got, hallelujah. God's got his prophets. He's got his servants. He's got his ministers. He's got his people who, by the word of their testimony and by the blood of the Lamb, because they do not love their life unto the death, won't even shut up for nothing.
Amen.
Amen. No, what we hope is we hope that there comes a revival of God's word. We pray and we believe that there would come a revival of people accepting what God said in his word, embracing the experience, having the experience, and living the experience. And out of that, there comes an awakening. Out of that, there comes sinners are taught the ways of God. Amen. Amen. And transgressors are converted. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Or we could say that sinners are transgressors are taught the way of God and sinners are converted. Amen.
Amen.
Either way it works, but the latter is the way that the psalmist said it. Hallelujah. Tikato ramanjesi kapitaya. Mestukona michisa petusta. Hallelujah. Moda and it bitchishi. Limanta prisitala mokuya shapaya. Nesta tomo te akiapa. And what you have to understand is the powers of darkness, that Satan, the demonic realm, is very real, very present, and very influential. And there's only one way that you're going to be able to stand against the powers of darkness, and that is, number one, you're going to submit yourself to God. You're going to submit yourself to God's word. The scripture says that his word abides in us. He said, I write unto you, young men, because God's word abides in you, and you have defeated Satan at every point. He tells us that we've overcome the world by our faith. And we've overcome the world by the testimony, by the confession of our faith. And that faith is not understood within the framework of some philosophy or ideology or what you believe about God and what your personal preferences, what your personal opinions are based upon the recent article you read out of whatever, you know, Reader's Digest. It is clearly defined by the word of God. It is clearly defined by the Spirit of the Lord as being born again and made a new creation. There is no such faith. There is no faith outside of being a new creation. God says nothing matters to me. Circumcision, uncircumcision has nothing. Means nothing. All that means anything to me is someone who's been made a new creation, a new creature. That's why Jesus Christ died. Jesus Christ died at Calvary's cross to destroy the power of sin so that sin would no longer have dominion over you and me, so that we would no longer live in sin.
Amen.
He bore our sins in his own body on the tree so that we now being dead, cut off, unresponsive to sin, might now live unto righteousness by whose wound we were healed. The whole born again experience is to say that you believe with your heart unto righteousness. With your confession is made unto salvation, and you believe in your heart unto righteousness. Now we have the rise of the apostate and the heresy at another level, where especially in Southern California, you got all these preachers, and boy, you know, a lot of folks listening to them, they're saying that we're all unrighteous and that we're professional sinners and that's okay because somehow Jesus fixed it up with God. That's nuts. That is nuts. That is so whacked out. It is so foreign to Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. It's foreign. It's absolutely demonic. It is absolutely doctrines born right out of hell to net and imprison men with the lies that will ultimately leave them in bondage to sin, and they'll spend an eternity in a place called the lake of fire. I mean, we're starting a fast today. And, you know, one thing you can think about, if you should decide you're not sure whether you want to go spend eternity in heaven or in hell, just know this, there will never be any food or drink in hell. You will never know what it means to have your thirst satisfied. You'll never know what it means to not be hungry, desperately hungry. That right there is pretty much hell, if you just said that. But even worse than that, there is no presence of God. All you have is fear. All you have is everything that is produced and hate and the iniquity that is all that possesses the devil and his angels. That's it. And it's still more than that. Because the Lord says that when they're cast into the lake of fire, he says the smoke of their torment will come up before him day and night forever. And they will be destroyed before the presence, before the face of the Lamb and of the Father for eternity. Now, that is a place of complete and total outer darkness where there's also a flame. Somebody said, that just shows you, you know. Yeah, it's not true. It's metaphorical. Goodness gracious. It just shows you that it's not true and that it's metaphorical, because if you had where there's fire, there is light. But had they just been trained in chemistry, they would realize that you can have what's called dark reactions, where you can have fire, extreme heat with no light. So reality of it is, when men basically thinks that he's figured this all out and that he, through his own reason, has really come to a clear justification of why the Bible is wrong. Hello. It's just because of your ignorance. It's some form or fashion. Huh? I'm telling you right now, when the world thought that the earth was flat, the Bible said it was round. I mean, come on. It's just... And the reality of it is if men were given enough time in the pursuit of knowledge, they would ultimately be able to understand that everything that God said is true, and they would be able to prove that God is true in every dimension. It's just that men is such slow learners. Number one, they won't get it in their lifetime, and so they're eternally lost. And how many generations will it take? You know, the reality of it is the beautiful thing is God has given to us his word. He's given us the insight and the revelation of his word to know exactly how things are and to know how he's thinking and know what he's expecting and what he wants. And then he gives to us the ability and the power. He enables us with everything that we need so that the Holy Ghost comes and he draws us and he compels us to come. Unfortunately, a devil met you at the altar and told you not to take it too seriously, to recognize it's okay, you're going to sin more or less, don't worry about it, you know, because God just accepts us all like we are. No, he doesn't. He doesn't. False. Total heresy. Not in the Bible. He calls us like we are. He calls all men, no matter who they are, he calls them. But he changes us to make us acceptable unto him. He makes us holy and acceptable unto him, so that we might render our reasonable service as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto him. I just tell you right now, there is no way that you can get out of walking in righteousness and holiness. In fact, heaven's all about people who want to walk in righteousness and holiness, who want to be taught the ways of God, who want to come and learn to walk in his judgments and to walk in his statutes. Hey, look, if you're in love with sin and iniquity and you have pleasure in unrighteousness, read 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 9. God said he's going to take pleasure in destroying everyone who has pleasure in unrighteousness, right along with the Antichrist and the devil. Now, I know what happens, that many people are so under the influence of a demon spirit, an angel of darkness called humanism, that they can't even begin to relate to this because they have now read all the scriptures through the lens and through the shade and filter of humanism. And a God of love is not going to destroy anybody. I beg to differ with you. A God of love is said from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. He's going to get the job done. He says he's going to create a new heaven and a new earth where there is no sin. He will rid sin out of the earth, the prophet said, to where that it will not even be able to be remembered. It won't even be a possibility. People will try to think, how could have it been? And they won't be able to put it together. Woo! And I'm all caught up in that kingdom. And that's the kingdom of righteousness and holiness. That's the one where Father comes and lives in. That's the one he's invited us into. That's the one he made very clear in the Old Testament that every bit of humanity that was caught in the currents of the demonic realm of darkness and of sin had no place with him. He said, draw not nigh. That's what he said. He said, set bonds and limits and tell anybody if they cross those bonds and limits, they're going to be destroyed. They're not touching my holiness. They're not touching. They're not even, I'm up here in the top of the mountain, but they're not going to even, they're not even going to touch the very surface of this mountain in any way. Now he says to all humanity, peace. He says, come on in. Anyone come. Come behold me. Anybody can come. The door's open. But many people are, as Jesus described, they're at the narrow gate. They're at the narrow entrance. That's how Jesus described it. It would be like coming up to a great high wall. As it reached it, and it went up into heaven as far as you could see. And it was as wide as possibly you could imagine. There would be no finding any way around. But there was an only... It was only one entrance into this realm, and it was a very narrow wall. And he says, narrow is the entrance. And he says that people stand outside of it, and agamitse in the Greek language, they agonize about entering in. Because he says, what I have is very strict. Another way to find it is very narrow. It's just enough room for you to get one foot in front of the other. It's narrow. It's a tightrope. It's very strict. My way is very strict. And there are very few people who come this way. After 1656 years, the demonic and the angels of darkness had so taught men how to sin that their imagination and their heart were only wicked continue. They picked it right continually. They picked it back right up after the flood. And Ham's descendants took right off. And they brought it and will bring it all the way to what we will see in the great apostasy of the tribulation. But he says, wide is the way that leads unto destruction. That's humanism. Everybody, there's many ways to God, and God loves us all. Kumbaya, we're all God's children. No. Until you've been born again, your father is the devil. He was basically saying that to Nicodemus in the scripture that I just read to you. And of course, if you go on to a few more chapters in John chapter 8 and verse 48, you will hear him say to the Pharisees, your father is the devil. You don't know who I am and you don't know my father. Your father is the devil and his deeds are what you do. Huh. Now the humanists are sitting around. Now they're calling 911. And they're saying, away with such a man. It's not right he should live. He's saying that our father is the devil and that his father is God. That's exactly what I'm saying. Just to make sure that the point is being made. If you've not been born again and made a new creation and reshaped in the image of righteousness and true holiness and received a new heart and a new spirit, and having now received the Spirit of the Lord God as he's put it in you according to his prophet Ezekiel 36:26, and according to what he said by his prophet Jeremiah in Jeremiah chapter 33:30, then your father is the devil, because we're not all children of God. You were born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And there was no way that who you are, what you are, is acceptable to God. That's why Jesus said, the early philosophers rejected John chapter 3. By and large, it wasn't taught inside of the Roman Catholic Church. This whole notion that somehow that which is born of the flesh is flesh and is not acceptable to God. You're foreign to God and alien from him. He does not know you. And people say, I just don't even believe that in the Bible. No, Jesus said, listen, he said, there's going to be people, and he says this in Matthew chapter 7, it's not the only place. He said, there are people come in that day and they'll say, Lord, Lord. Now, when you do a doublet, either in the Hebrew language or in the Greek language, it means absolutely, okay? So if any word is doubled, it means it's absolutely that. So they're saying, he's absolutely my Lord. I love Jesus and he loves me and I know him and he knows me. But you continue in sin. You have sin going on in your life. He's going to say to you, even if you have some kind of great signs and wonders and miracle, he's going to say, depart from me, you that work iniquity, I do not know you. And this is just the way he's going to bring it down. You know, John was so radical about it in 1 John chapter 3. He said, everyone that does righteousness is righteous even as he is righteous. I would say to you today, tonight, do you know that you're righteous even as Christ Jesus is righteous? Do you know that right there I would lose the majority of the people that say they're on their way to heaven and their name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life? They cannot confess the word. They have compromised so much that they don't even repent for sin anymore. They go on and tell lies. I mean, hey, praise God for his mercy and his grace. The blood of Jesus Christ is there to forgive us and cleanse us. But if our heart's been hardened through sin, if we've been deceived by such lies, then we're going to lie, and then we're not going to ask the Lord to come and forgive us, and there's not going to be a Holy Ghost conviction of repentance to turn from that and not do it, and a laying hold of the covenant to now be cleansed from it, and you're going to be stained by sin. And that's just the way it is. And it's even getting worse. Because God, the Holy Ghost, brings a holiness, a presence of holiness that is grieved by sin and wrongdoing, and that loves righteousness and loves the ways of God and loves purity and loves all those things that pertain to the fruits of the Spirit and the nature of God. And now they've been brought into prison and they've been deceived by the devil, by lies. They've been brought into prison by lies. The truth will set you free. A lie will bring you into prison. The word of God is truth. God, the Holy Ghost, is the Spirit of truth. He will lead us and guide us in all truth. He's going to lead us and guide us in doing the word of God and empowering us to do the word of God. But if we don't follow, if we're going to believe something else, then we're basically taken out. He said, everyone that does righteousness is righteous even as he is righteous. But he that sins is of the devil. I mean, I could give a lot of things that Paul said similar to this, but let me just go on just a minute with John. He goes on to say, he said, they that are born of God cannot sin. It's the very next verse. He says, for the seed remains in them and they cannot sin. Twice, the same verse. Well, my pastor said, and I was reading a lexicon, and it said, no, I don't care what the leprechaun or the lexicon said. The Bible said, the Word of God said, for me, that's like, woo! For me, it's the voice of deliverance. For them, it's like, ah! Because they want to continue on in the world. They don't want to be separate from the world. The notion and the idea of separation from the world and not living in worldliness. In fact, the idea and notion of worldliness has completely lost any meaning in 1915. To not participate with the world, to come out from among them, be separate, to have no worldliness. People don't even know what that is. They don't even know what it is. You know, I pray that you begin to spend more time with the Lord Jesus this year. Just being alone with him, a place called prayer, get to know him. See how shocked he is about the way people are living. Because God hasn't changed. He's not living 2,000 years ago. He's living way out in the future. But 2,000 years ago, he came and presented what looks way out in the future. And it was purity and holiness, man, and it was beautiful. Hallelujah. And there was no sin and no blemish and none, all the stuff that goes on in the lives of people. Listen, I'm telling you right now, I mean, people in the world would not watch on television. People 50 years ago, 60 years ago, people in the world would not watch on television what Christians now bathe themselves in their movie marathons. And there's no conviction. And they sit there and they watch stuff because they live inundated and anesthetized by it. Now somebody like me comes walking in the room who's hooked up with the Holy Ghost and goes, what are you doing? Somebody said, do you go to this place or you go to that place? No, I don't go to this place, then I go to that place.
What, you religious, legalistic? No. If I go near to such a place, I'm grieved and vexed. The Holy Ghost inside of me is grieved and vexed. I'm not sorry. I've not been branded and tattooed by the devil. My conscience has not been seared with sin. My heart's not hardened through iniquity. I'm a little bit sensitive to God still. And I want to be a whole lot more sensitive. Hallelujah. Come on, just come get separated right to the Lord. Just find yourself. Just shut off all the television, shut off the radio and all the rest of the nonsense in your conversations with everybody who wants to validate your iniquity. Huh? Get along with God. Get along with His Word. Just shut in with His Word of God and the Spirit of God. And all of a sudden, you're going to find out you haven't been living right. Rut-row. Or as they say in Japan, oh, really? Yeah. That's what you're going to discover. Hey, it's easy to walk with God. It's wonderful around to walk. God just got to quit talking bad about people. It's wonderful. It's a glorious place to walk with God. Just got to quit hating people and living in unforgiveness. It's easy to walk with God. Just got to be willing to be filled with His love and His glory and His splendor. Hallelujah. Which fulfills all the law. Because when you walk in that kind of love, there's not going to be any sin. Because you don't have eyes to look after lust anymore. And to look after iniquity. And to look after covetousness. And to look after things out of a greedy self-interest way from which all sin arises. Hello. I know it's just so hard not to live hateful. It's so hard not to live in the iniquity of self-abuse and abusing everybody else and greedy getting whatever you can to satisfy some insatiable lust. Huh? Are you listening to me? Because I'm telling you what's going on over here. I'm just trying to help shine the light upon the reality, the situations that confront your life and the abuses that are imposed upon humanity to present for you the opportunity to commit acts of violence and treason against the Almighty, which everybody says we just can't quit from doing it nor cease from it. Well, Peter said in 2 Peter chapter 3, he said, they have eyes full of adultery, who cannot cease from sin, whose damnation is just. It's about time that somebody on the planet begins to get a fear of the Lord in their life and begins to come into an agreement with the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of Holiness, begins to get on God's side instead of somewhere in between where Father is and where the demonic realm is. It's about time we start recognizing that everyone who's born of God, they knew. Paul, here's how John said it. It says, we know. I like to quote the verse of Scripture, they knew. We know that everyone who's born of God does not sin. And you know how many times John makes that point? You know, I just challenge you. One of the first epistles of the Bible that I memorized was the first epistle of John, second, third epistles of John. I just challenge you, memorize them. Because all of a sudden you're going to think more about what's being said. And then people come on the radio and start preaching their preacher sermons. Huh? And their doctrinal bias to denominational, you know, differences. You're going to go, wait a minute. That's not what the Bible says. Huh? I don't know, man. I guess I would just prepare myself to be thrown in prison in some third world country for Jesus, and I have the Bible with me. Huh? I just took up in my heart that, wait a minute, I really want to walk with God. I really want to live with Him, for Him. I don't want to have some kind of half measure. I don't want to do this religious thing. Huh? I don't want to say that I'm a follower of Jesus and still act like the devil. I'm really interested in being completely delivered from all this mess. I don't want any of it. I want heaven. Huh? I began to define the lifestyle of sin in the world as hell. For me, it was hell. That's hell. That's iniquity. That's companionship with the powers of darkness, the enemies of God. I want heaven. I want to know you, Father. I want to walk with you, Lord Jesus. And He opened up the door and says, come on in, man. We're going to take good care of you. We're going to baptize you in the Holy Ghost, too. and we're going to give you so much ability and so much power. I'm going to come live inside of you. And Father's going to come live on the inside of you. And Holy Ghost, we all three going to come live on the inside of you. And people think I'm just making it up. No, it's John chapter 4, verse 17 through 23. That's what He said. He said, in that day.
the day that the Holy Ghost comes upon you. In that day, you will know that the Father is in me and that I'm in you. Ooh, I had that day. And now he walks in me and he lives in me. And I bear about in my body the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, that I might bear in my body the life of Jesus also. So that Jesus Christ may be made manifest in my mortal flesh. Somebody said, that's not in the Bible. Sorry, it is. To me, it's a joyful sound. I'm sorry that to many people it's threatening and intimidating, and all of a sudden it makes them feel like that they're not even right with God. I've had preachers say after I finished ministering, man, I don't even know if I'm saved. I said, well, I want to bring you into the assurance of salvation. Amen. Hallelujah. I want to bring you into the assurance of salvation. I want to beseech you to be reconciled unto God, to be changed, to come over here now and to be made partaker of his righteousness. Who bore our sins, the one who knew no sin, became the sin offering so that we may be made the righteousness of God in him. And so Paul had an experience where he discovered the righteousness of God, to where now he no longer needed the righteousness of the law. He stepped into the mystery of the fellowship of Christ in him, his confidence of glory, all by a wonderful free gift where the Spirit of the Lord came upon him and changed him into a new creation, into a new creature. He there understood in Galatians 1:17 that God had purposed to reveal his Son in him. Hallelujah. And that the new covenant was now this wonderful, glorious relationship of Holy Ghost union. And we're the temple of the living God. Paul said, what? You guys got sin going on in your life? What are you crazy? Don't you know that you're the temple of God? And that you can't have any fellowship with devils and communion with devils? What? What? You're saying that you're going to continue in sin that grace may abound? Are you out of your mind? Which is a better way to translate that particular phrase than to say, God forbid, because it doesn't mean God forbid. It's a particular colloquialism. It's an, are you out of your mind? Or we could say in modern lingo, are you out of your stinking mind? Have you completely lost all sense of reality? It's another good way of saying it. I'm just trying to make the point. I'm underscoring here. I got the highlighter out. Bright pink. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How can we continue in sin? We've been delivered from it. Hallelujah. Did you know the old man is crucified? He's been put to death. A former life doesn't exist. Old things have passed away. It's been cut off. Behold, all things are new. You're of God. You're a new creation. You're a new man. You're possession of the new nature. You got a new heart. You got a new spirit. You belong to God. He's fulfilled the law of his righteousness in you. Hallelujah. You don't walk after the flesh anymore, after human ability, but after the spirit. But you not in the flesh any longer, but in the spirit, because that which is born of the flesh is flesh, and that which is born of the spirit is spirit. Don't you realize that when Paul took up the message in Romans chapter 8, all he's doing is basically helping us understand with greater clarity what Jesus said in John chapter 3, verses 1 through 6. He's just repeating John chapter 3, verses 1 through 6 in Holy Ghost words. Not in his own words, but in Holy Ghost words. Amen. So that we might say it is the word of God. Spoken through Paul, just like the word of God was spoken through Jesus. Isn't that amazing? Like the word of God was spoken through Jesus. Hallelujah. And anybody who has the word of God in them right now are going to speak just like Jesus and speak just like Paul. Hallelujah. And if they don't speak just like Jesus and just like Paul, then the scripture says they have no light in them. And if the light that is in them be darkness, how great is that darkness? Because the people that are deceived, that believe that they're right, but they're wrong, how great is that deception? Is there any way to get a person out of that deception? Father has opened up the door for us to come live in heaven. I mean, you know, when you think about Deuteronomy chapter 11, where the Lord says to Israel, keep my commandments, do what I'm telling you to do, and you'll have days of heaven on earth. I bless you in the field. I bless you in the house. You'll find everything about your life full of my peace and my joy and my goodness.
How much more now that we live in the new covenant, in the brightness and the glory of now Father having come and making his dwelling on the inside of us, having come and tabernacled on the inside of us, how living on the inside of us, day in, day out, our spirit joining us unto the Lord. When you just think about living in goodness, you know that Papa's willed that you never live a day out of goodness? Somebody said, oh man, come on, give me a break. I mean, surely, and the Lord expects that we're going to have some bad days. Well, the fruit of the Spirit is goodness. The kingdom of God is in all goodness. The kingdom of God is righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Ghost. The fruit of the Spirit, and God says, if you're born in the Spirit, then you live in the Spirit and you walk in the Spirit. If you're born of the Holy Ghost, you live in the Holy Ghost, you walk in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Then what you're going to have is you're going to have love, the Holy Ghost love, Jesus kind of love. Not human love, not I love Arco Prices love, not I love Walmart love, but the Holy Ghost love, the kind of love that Jesus expressed to us, what the Father expressed to us when he laid down his life for us, when he gave himself for us because he seemed us better than himself. Hello. Look around. See who you're going to lay your life down for in this place. I mean, whose feet are you even willing to wash? Huh? Without a respirator on. And gloves. Like a surgeon going into surgery. When I was a little guy, they had foot washing services all the time. And you know, some of the pastors, some of the people moving and discerning the spirit, discerning the spirits had a great way of pairing everybody up. He knew who didn't like who. He knew who was harboring something against somebody else. You know, just get to wash anybody's feet at random. Hallelujah. Praise God. He knew who was all being all uppity. Hallelujah. Like Peter. Huh? Hallelujah. Oh, dear people. The privilege that we have to live the good life, the God life, the life of Jesus. We know that the Lord's getting ready to send us all over the United States. I mean, we just praise God for all the things we've been able to do internationally and through the world, and we're going to continue to do that. I mean, right now, we've got 7 on the radar internationally for this year, about 12, 14 for the United States of America. We know it's growing. Things are happening continually with that momentum, and because the Lord's put it in our hearts and told us to go tell his people to receive the life of Jesus. Go tell the people that sit in the church it's time to receive the life of Jesus. You've been living your own life too long. You're supposed to be crucified with Christ right now. You're supposed to be buried with him by baptism into his death. You're supposed to be raised up together with him, alive together with him, and seated together with him in heaven and realm, having now received the life of Jesus, the life of God, the life of the Holy Ghost, to where you no longer live. What's wrong with you now? What's the problem? Huh? Where there's a floodgate of heaven open to you, supply from on high, to where you're being continually filled with this love, this joy, this peace. When so full, the enemy comes along and goes, I don't have any room for anything. I'm just full. You're so full that you're gushing out, not just with a little bit, but rivers flowing out of you. How can you take anything else in that the enemy's coming along when you so overwhelmed, so filled up with the pleasures from on high, the pleasures that are at his right hand, hallelujah, and the joy that is in his presence. I mean, the enemy just invades a vacuum. He invades a place of discouragement and disappointment, a sense of separation, a place where you're not fulfilled, a place where you're not complete. What happens when you step into the whole counsel of God and begin to believe this word of life and this word of faith and take a hold of these things, this glorious salvation, this so great a salvation that you've been invited into, and you begin to live this abundant life? You're not gonna be taken out by the devil. I mean, Job, Old Testament Job. Old Testament. Law. Old Testament Job. Actually, it's pre-law between Abraham and Moses, more than likely. He was righteous and perfect in all of his ways. Somebody said, I just don't believe it. Well, then guess what God said? You're going to have to make God a liar. Because that's what God said. That was God's testimony of him. And God put a hedge around him. Satan said to God, you have a hedge around him. I can't touch him.
Well, my goodness, you and I are baptized in the glory cloud of heaven. Yeah. Come on. We baptized in the fire of God. We baptized in the Holy Ghost. That's better than a hedge any day of the year. Amen. Yeah. Hallelujah. That's better than any hedge. It's just that we tend to leave out of the realms of that which God has called us to because we've been integrated with earthly things. We've been integrated with worldly things, and we've not made a demarcation. We've compromised with the devil, and he's going to move in. He's going to be able to execute certain areas of his wickedness on your life up until a certain point. If you've never murdered anybody, I doubt you've ever been here being tempted with murdering anyone right now. I believe that for you to murder someone, you have to nurture hate for a long time. You have to feed hate to yourself. Huh? There's a difference when a young man is put upon a war battlefield with a gun and he's been trained in boot camp how to indiscriminately take a target and kill it. Just close your eyes, take a target and kill it. And it goes from just a basic target to something that looks more like a human being. There's still a preparation to kill, though. Huh? But once you cross that line, uh-oh, you better watch out because now you can be tempted. You listen to me? Yeah. Oh, well, we're not going to do that because we got this little... Well, all sin and iniquity is just as bad. A lie is the same as murder. Hate is the same as murder. Hate is the same as murder. That's what he said. That's what God said. I mean, just pick that right up. You don't know about that verse of Scripture. You just pick that right up there from where I was quoting there in 1 John chapter 3. There's more verses of Scripture on it than that. But you pick it right up there at 1 John chapter 3, verse 10. You can see. Why did Cain kill his brother? Why did Cain murder his brother? Because Abel's deeds were righteous. And what that did was then that made Cain to be unveiled and revealed to be the unrighteous person he was. And so he hated him. And nothing's changed in the heart of men. That's why so many people hate me. They hate the light. That's why they hated Jesus. He said, if I hadn't revealed their sin, then they wouldn't hate me. But because now I've come as the light and revealed their sin, there's no more cloak for it. It's true. And all we got to do is not talk about our own personal opinion, but just declare the word of God. I want to talk about all the bad stuff. I want to talk about all the good stuff. People have been so deceived by all the bad stuff. I'll step in there and minister and try to stir that pot around a little bit. Say, wait a minute, jump out that thing. I mean, that's a compromising situation you in. You're about to heat up and die. It's too good. Jesus couldn't find a way to express it. It was too good to tell. So he said abundant life. When you say abundant, that's more than you can think of. That's what that means. It's superly abundantly beyond. It's more than can be received. It's more than enough. It's beyond enough. It's abundant. Whew. And the Lord invites us in to come and to know all his fullness. He says, you can be filled with all my fullness. He says, you can know the love of Christ which passes knowledge and be filled with all my fullness. And he said, now, unto him who is able to do a super abundantly above all that you can think or ask according to the power that is at work on the inside of you. You don't even have to go get something else and bring him down. He's already come and lived on the inside of you to bring all of this just through this wonderful, wonderful, wonderful grace. This beautiful majesty and splendor that he's put upon our life. The only thing that makes you ugly is sin. Listen to me. The only thing that makes you ugly is sin. Oh, isn't it wonderful when you divested of all such things, hallelujah, by the precious, wonderful gift of the Holy Ghost. This wonderful gift of salvation, this wonderful gift of being made a new creation where there's now no more condemnation, no more guilt, no more shame, no more offense, no more sense of sin, no more sense of sin. The offerer once purged, there's no more need for another offering. There's no more defilement anymore. Hallelujah. Whew. Praise God. come walk over here in the life of God. Come walk by the Spirit. As many as are led by the Spirit, they're the sons of God. Be certain of this. If you're not led by the Holy Ghost, you're not the Son of God, sons of God. It's just really time. Come over here and enjoy all this wonderful thing that God has given us called enduring patience, kindness, goodness. Hallelujah. Meekness. Faith. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. All these wonderful things. I mean, just God's given us the privilege of living joy unspeakable all day long. All you have to do is stop agreeing with the situation and the circumstances to not have joy unspeakable, to not have peace, to not have goodness, to not live in heaven. Because as long as you're crying out, saying, Lord, I want heaven, I want your goodness, I want your joy, I'm going to tell you right now, all heaven's mobilized to make sure that you have everything that Father's promised. People are interested in stuff that you shouldn't even be interested in. Nothing. Meaningless. Money. And everybody's crying out, oh God. We cry, we have an altar call for everybody who has a financial need. The altars are full. More anointing. Few people come. The true riches is like, can you spend it? Can I get what I really want with it? Because I'm running in the same current of the rest of the world, and it's all about what I can have stuff. That just need to stop. You need to define worldliness for yourself tonight. It's a great night because we're closing a chapter. It's a great time to say, okay, you know what? After so long a time as this, I'm going to follow God. I'm going to do it His way. I'm going to live fully for Him. I'm going to do exactly what He said. I'm going to live how He said. Because having begun in the Spirit, you don't have to try to make perfect yourself. Having begun in the Spirit, you're now made perfect by your own human ability. God forbid. Having begun in the Spirit, God the Holy Ghost will perfect you. Having been shaped, having been born in righteousness, now you're every day shaped in purity, in His holiness, shaped in his ways. Every day to grow and mature under the mentorship, under the leadership of the Holy Spirit. All you got to do is want to. All you got to do is you got to suddenly find that prayer and praise and thanksgiving is wonderful things to be doing. That's way. It's far better than the football game. It's far better than shuffleboard and pinochle and whatever it is that you're doing. That doesn't satisfy. That doesn't nurture anything in your life. That doesn't take you over into a realm of participating with the unseen, where Father exists. Huh? You know, we talked to you some about prayer last night and the transformation, the changes, and the things that prayer will do for your life that you cannot even begin to conceptualize. That it's so multi. There's so many multiple facets of it. So many multiple dimensions of it, of all that God does when you just sit there before His presence, when you learn how to enjoy His presence. People all frustrated, trying so hard. There's a place of learning at it. Listen, I believe in supplication. It's a different kind of prayer, with all prayer and supplication in the Holy Ghost. Daniel set his face to seek God with prayer and supplication, with fastings, in prayer and supplications, in sackcloth and ashes, which is taken to another level of humbling yourself before the Lord. But, and supplications are that petitioning prayer, that place where you're banging on the door till Father arises. Huh? The parable of the man who continues to bang on the door until his neighbor opens up the door and gets him the things that he's requesting. The woman of Luke chapter 18. This is why men ought to always pray the petitioning prayer or the prayer of supplication. Look at the widow who comes and wearies the judge. The petitioning prayer. But there's something about coming into this place in Him of where we just enter into His presence. We enter into this communication with Him of where we're just enjoying His presence. And then it becomes to where it becomes, it's a part of all your day. Whew, hallelujah. Sounds like heaven, doesn't it? It sounds like walking in the Spirit, doesn't it? It sounds about being born again. Doesn't that sound like abundant life? Doesn't that sound like the life of Jesus? Doesn't that sound like being taken over by the power of the living God? Father walking in you, living in you, where all of a sudden you're captivated by his presence. It's a breakthrough. I know it's a barrier. I know people look at me with a question mark in one eye and an exclamation mark in the other eye. And I understand that because you got to break through a barrier. But I'm going to tell you right now, you ought to break through this barrier before you break through the other one. Because very soon you're going to break through a barrier from this world into the next world, and you'd be better be ready. Amen. Pretty soon you're getting ready to break through a barrier. You're getting ready to see how much stuff is around you. You're getting ready. Some of you in here aren't going to live another 40 years. Some of you may not live another 30 years that are in this room. I didn't much time. You better seek the Lord. You better set your heart to seek the Lord. People have this smug attitude like, I'm good. Paul said he walked in the fullness of the measure of the ministry of Jesus. He said he came in the fullness of the power, the fullness of the gospel, and the demonstration of the Holy Ghost and power with mighty signs and wonders. And then after he said that, after he said Jesus was manifested in mortal flesh, he said, oh, that I may know him. That I may know him. And the power of his resurrection. This is what he said, that I may be conformed, that I may be conformed into his death, that I may fellowship with his sufferings, that if I might by any means possible attain unto the resurrection of the dead. That's a direct quote from Philippians chapter 3. He said, I suffered for Jesus, I've suffered the loss of all things and count it but dung, that I might win Christ. I don't believe there's any such thing as taking God for granted and being right with him. I don't believe a position of lukewarmness. Can I define lukewarmness for you? It's less than being on fire with the fire of the Holy Ghost. You either hot, on fire, with the fire of the Holy Ghost, and that's defined. What the Word of God clearly defines what it means to be baptized in the fire of the Holy Ghost. To be red hot. Hallelujah. Huh? Yes. Or you're cold. You don't know God at all. You're completely alienated from him. There's no interaction whatsoever. And Jesus said, I would rather have either one of those. But he says to his church, if you look warm, if you're indifferent, if you have a que sera theology, if there's not the passion in you, if you in any way indifferent about these things, he said, I'll spew you out of my mouth. And it is a Middle Eastern way of expressing total disdain for a person's presence. It's what you do to your enemy. They hand you something, you go, and then go. Take a little sip of it, you spit it out. Complete disdain for their presence. Humanism doesn't believe that Jesus is like that because he's the lowly Lamb of Galilee. Who just loves everybody. He loves everybody, and he's the lowly Lamb of Galilee that took a whip and drove everybody out of the temple that was making a mess, that wasn't doing what God said. He's the lowly Lamb of Galilee that's going to come with his hair white as snow. Hallelujah. White like wool. So that's the Lord's hair is more like yours, Jonathan, than mine. His hair is white like wool's. Eyes of flame and fire. He would take vengeance and execute judgment upon all the ungodly for the ungodly deeds which they ungodly did and pour out the wrath of God without measure. Who is this who comes with his garments dipped in blood from Bozrah? Who slays the wicked with the breath of his mouth? Comes with a sharp two-edged sword. Executing vengeance. What's his vengeance all about? God hates iniquity. He hates sin. His wrath is stored up against it. And that's why Paul and all the other prophets and ministers cried out and said, flee from the wrath that is to come. Wrath on what? Sin. Can you show me an example? Yeah. I thought the law was done away with. Let me show you a pre-law example. The flood. There was no law. There was no law there. People all say, well, when the law is taken away, there's no more offense because the law reveals the sin. You don't even know what you're saying. You don't even know what the scripture means. Because there was no law when Adam sinned and he died spiritually and separated from God. There was no law when God executed his judgment against all the ungodly during the flood. There was no law. God said, Sodom and Gomorrah, it's over. I'm going to annihilate those people. I'm going to annihilate them. There's no law. He said, these would-be theologians and people who supposedly have insight to Bible doctrine begin to say, because the law was removed by the work of Calvary, so now sin no longer has a power to destroy. You know, I have no idea what you're saying. You're a deceiver and you're deceiving. You're fulfilling what the scripture said, that there would be seducing spirits and doctrines of devils. Dear people, don't be deceived. Everyone that does righteous is righteous and as he is righteous. That's the way the scripture opens up. Did you know that? Let no man deceive you. That's what he says. That's what John said. And of course, Paul said the same thing in Ephesians chapter 5. He says, don't let any money deceive you, because because of these things, the wrath of God comes upon the children of disobedience. Father's got available. The good news is Father has made available for a way for you to have every stain of sin erased. Hallelujah. He's made a way for you to now take a hold of the spirit of obedience and live out your life every day for him. Hallelujah. He's made a way to where that you can step into heaven. You can come on into the holies of holies. I mean, come on in the holies of holies. With all boldness, come on in the holies of holies and don't leave. Because reality of it is the Holy Holies came into you. Oh, hallelujah. The good news is that Satan and sin and death have no more power over you. Oh, I know. If you're not walking with him, filled up with his glory, that Satan comes peddling his goods and he can entice you with them. And he can make sin look very pleasurable. But all you have to have is a little bit of wisdom and know that the wages of sin is death. Realize that the consequence of that disobedience is to give way to the power of Satan and the power of hell upon your life. And it's like, I'm not doing, I don't want that. Father, help me. Come deliver me. The enemy of my soul is trying to snare me. I tell you, have him mobilized. Whew. And then you just stand over there just, you know, enjoy unspeakable kind of drunk in the Holy Ghost while God fights your battles for you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Then you get to walk around in the splendor being dressed up with these beautiful garments. These garments of praise. You get to walk around in your priestly majesty. Hallelujah. In the crown of righteousness because you've endured temptation. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And a crown of righteousness has been given to you. Praise the name of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I pray that you leave the former things behind. I pray that you go ahead and grab a hold of this heavenly vision as you step into 2016 and say, okay, make an agreement with the Holy Ghost. Say, Holy Spirit, you know I've been taking charge most of the time, but I'm going to give you charge all the time. Holy Ghost, I'm just going to walk with you. I want to learn to hear you. I want to learn to hear your voice. I want to learn to be filled up with all that you're supplying. I'm going to stop going in my own thinking. I'm going to walk in the mind of the Spirit. You know, the mind of the Spirit, the mind of Christ is easy to have. People act like that they got to try to attain it through some kind, you know, of second work of grace. The mind of the Spirit, the mind of Christ is simply living by the Word of God. Hallelujah. And then somebody said, I don't have a good memory. No problem. God, the Holy Ghost will bring these things into your remembrance, everything that Jesus has said. Hallelujah. And then besides that, you're every day in the Word. because it's your daily food. It's your daily bread. You live by the word. Hallelujah. Yet the living word lives in you. Hallelujah. And the written word strengthens you. Hallelujah. And causes you to understand how to cooperate with the living word who lives on the inside of you. Thank you, Jesus. I pray that you'll just devour the word while you're fasting. Hallelujah. Just get yourself so filled up. It's like, wow, I'm filled up. I had a huge meal of the word of God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, living God. Jesus. Well, I want to have communion with you here. Did somebody get some? Yeah, they did. I'm going to have communion with you. Good. I almost thought I saw styrofoam cups for just a moment. I'm like, goodness gracious, we can't poison people while we're having communion. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. You guys want to go over there and start putting all that together? Elizabeth, go help them, would you? You know, the table of communion is about, it's supposed to be the testimony of how we live. It's not supposed to be some kind of sacrament by which by some means we now become more right with God. It is a testimony of how we live. And see, as often as we do this, we show his death until he comes. So when we do this, we're not only talking about his death, but we're talking about his coming. We show his death till he comes. So it's a testimony of both his death and his coming. And you got the resurrection in there, obviously, don't you? And of course, when you understand his death in terms of 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 9 and 10, you recognize that we carry around his death in our body, right? We bear his death in our body, the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, we bear in our body, that his life may also be revealed in us. Hallelujah. Masakinda libasa pritaya kushiala mahatapekani. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, thank you for the anointing. Sutaramontasia. Iprosataranamakishi pitulomo supaya lamahi. Ierebushalobokuristia. When we take a hold of the bread, Pia Shapruna Sate. Father, I ask you right now in the name of Jesus, touch every person in this place. Father, I ask you to sober every person up in this place in Jesus' name. Sever every person up in this place. May every man examine himself. May everyone recognize this wonderful price that you paid for us to have your life. That no one would eat or drink unworthily at this table. But everyone in eating and drinking at this table will be saying and recognizing that they're saying that they're going to live their life for you and by you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Bokota shene peya. Kuta patene sheya pura shingaya. Dekiri la boshe pekita la mosipesti katumani yaka. He risono ne minkani ya pushiala. Hallelujah. Jesus said this. He said that Moses did not give you the true manna, the true bread. He said, I am the bread. When we take a hold of communion, he's saying to us, he's saying, this is my body which was broken for you. We're declaring that we live by his life, that we've received his life into us, and that we live by his life. It is the token of the covenant. It is a means of fellowship and communion with God, just like the Passover feast was an opportunity within the framework of the covenant for people to come and sit down and have fellowship with the Lord in recognition that they are under His governorship and lived in His statutes and lived in His judgments, that they were His people and He is their God. And I pray tonight that as we have communion together and we're going into 2016 together here with this communion, that you recognize the word communion literally means fellowship, and that these are just emblems of the covenant that says, that describes and the beauty of our fellowship and the degree and price, the degree to what Father was willing to go to and the price that He was willing to pay so that we could have the fellowship. And it should have huge impacts upon us. That if He laid down His life for us, should we not lay down our life for Him? That we have this kind of an exchange going on? When He says, whatever you ask Me, I will do it. And that's exciting. But how about whatever He asks you? You will do it, because the covenant, it has always been an agreement of exchange. What I have is yours. And then the recipient of the covenant says, and what I have is yours. The one who institutes the covenant says, all that is mine, I make it yours. And then the recipient of the covenant says, all that is mine, I make it yours also. I pray that you'll let God come move into every dimension of your life. If there's any part of your life that you've been shutting the Lord out of, watch out. Things in our modern society can become very addictive and a huge distraction. And they can fill you almost with a sensation of calm and quiet and peace and relaxation. This is where you relax. People tell me, well, I've got to have a couple glasses of wine to relax. Someone tells me, well, I'm just going to have to sit down and watch a couple of movies to relax and unwind. Somebody says, well, I smoke dope to relax. After all, God made the herbs. I hear all this stuff. Well, have you found the rest that's in Christ Jesus? Have you found the relax and the beauty that's in walking in the Holy Ghost? Have you found the beauty of prayer and praise? Have you found the communion, the fellowship, the interaction with His body and with His blood and with His person, the interaction with all that He's made available? When His body was torn in two like bread, His body was torn in two so that the veil of the temple could be torn in two, that there would be no more barrier or partition, no more partition between Gentile and Jew, and no more partition or barrier between man and God. So my fellowship says, I now get to step in, and the value of my fellowship and the sacredness of it is that this bread that I take a hold of and this body that was broken for me is my access and my privilege now to live over here in the holies of holies. And all I'm doing at the communion table is I'm testifying that I have partaken of what God has provided through His body and through His blood. That's so, see, communion is so sacred to me. So sacred to me. It's so sacred. So sacred to me. There was a time in my life I wouldn't let anybody else do it because it was just so sacred to me. It's just too sacred to me. I was just uncomfortable with anybody doing it. And I got over that. But I haven't got it over it being very, very sacred. Somebody says, is it really His blood? No, but it kind of is to me. Is it really His body? No, but it kind of is to me. I tried my best to help people understand this, and because the Spirit of the Lord told me, I want you to continue to have communion. So I'd set the communion cup on the platform when I preached. And while I was ministering, I'd go and eat some of the bread and drink some of the communion. The whole time I'm ministering. Because that's my life. And it wouldn't be a bad thing. It would, in fact, be a good thing so long as you didn't make it a ritualistic thing. If somehow you are doing that all through the day, having communion, that you might be reminded, I'm showing forth his death until he comes. I'm telling you, I'm bearing his death in my body, that his life may also be revealed to me. Because if his death's not there, his life's not there. And if I'm not willing to partake of the death, I can't partake of the life, because the life came by way of the death. And that's what this says. I've got the life of Jesus, and I'm living by the life of Jesus. That's what Paul's saying, and that's what he means. And there's things he says in 1 Corinthians. There's things that he declares in chapter 11. Things that Jesus said, this is my body which is broken for you. And the moment that his body was broken, the moment that the blood came rushing out, the veil of the temple was torn. I mean, hey, yes, the whipping post was part of it, because by his stripes we were healed. That was part of the breaking. Praise God for the whipping post. I mean, look at the price he paid for me to be healed. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to be healed. You see, because if you have any other disposition about it, Satan will trample all over you, because he's a rebellious imp that will impose upon you whatever he decides if you allow it. He's rebellious against God. And he's defiant. He believes he owns you, in fact. I don't care who you think you are in God. It doesn't matter. He believes he can bring an army up and destroy God. He's deceived. He's a pathological liar. He's completely, totally deceived. He deceives and he's deceived. And he'll run right over top of you. This person, like, oh, if it be thy will, oh God, that I should be sick, that you might be able to teach me a lesson. That's nonsense. He went to the whipping post, that by his stripes you'd be healed. Where's the covenant? Where's the appreciation, the value, and the sacredness, and the belief of it? This is what God tells us. This is what he's saying. Let every man examine himself. It's not like you can't come. It's like, everybody come. Just get serious. It's like, examine yourself. You're not here just to eat, and this isn't refreshments. That's all that's about. You can't sit there and go, oh, I did something terrible today. I can't have communion. What? Man, I hope you don't die with an attitude like that. You're going to go to hell. You're going to miss out on God. You need to get right. You need to repent. Take forgiveness of sins right now. Man, if you do that to God, what do you do to other people? How long you make them repent before you forgive them? You know what I'm saying? Come on now. It's just a reflection of your what you do, what's going on inside. So you just go, wait a minute. I may have not understood it like I need to understand it, but I want to understand it. I may not have lived it like God's called me to live it, but I want to live it that way. I may not have been everything that Father's purposed me to be, but I want to be that. Somebody said, you mean you're sinless? That's not the issue. The issue is I don't want sin in my life. Somebody says, you mean you're perfect before the Lord? That's not the issue. The issue is I want to be perfect for him. Because that's what he said. Jesus said, be perfect even as your Father in heaven is perfect. I love to watch theologians squirm over that verse of scripture. Several others along those lines as well. I don't take that as a threat. I think that as an opportunity. Hallelujah. God empowers us. He invites us. When he says glorify him in our body and our spirit, which are his, he's not telling us to go to work. He's empowering us to have something that he's given. We could go, yippee, I get to. He said, oh my goodness, how am I going to get that done with all the rest of my workload? You understand, we need to hear right. Shema, the Hebrew word, Shema, is to hear right. It's to hear right. Shema, the Lord's always saying, hear. Hear, listen. Be careful how you hear. You need to hear right. You need to hear in the context of God's love and God's mercy. And you need to hear in the context of God's judgment and his indignation and wrath against sin. You need to hear right. That everyone who has ears to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to the churches. I know God the Holy Ghost stands right here at the crossroads of this time, looking for people to go with them. We are going into trouble sometimes. When it comes to the world and the governments of the world, we're going into great trouble sometimes. It's when it comes to the church, we're stepping into great glorious times. Father is getting ready to do some amazing things in the midst of his people. He's raised up and is raising up champions in him that will not bend nor bow to all the threats of the world, who will live completely and totally for him, who are willing to give themselves completely over to the power of the Holy Ghost. As we ministered to you last night, Satan has been able to take men like Alexander the Great, take men like Hitler, take men like Mussolini, and the names, listen, Napoleons, and make them great and evil men that have conquered the world. Oh, what the Holy Ghost would do through somebody who would give themselves completely over to him and to his realm. Oh, what God would do. Oh, what the power of God would do. And these are those days. You know, I'm turning 57 here in 2 months, and I've spent my entire life in the church, and I've watched many things happen in the church. And we are in a unique time. We are a very unique time in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Just hear the Lord. I was talking with a dear friend of mine, wonderful evangelist, the other day, and sharing some things with each other. He says, Mark, he said, all I can hear, the Spirit of the Lord Jesus keeps telling me, there's a place of holiness. There's a place of purity. Richard Moore, for those of you who know him. So all I can hear is the Spirit of the Lord's telling me, there's a place of holiness and purity that he wants me to exist in, he wants me to dwell in. He said, I've got this passion, this hunger, this cry on the inside of me to this place of total separation into the living God. And, you know, that's just me. That's my heartbeat. So somebody starts talking that way, man. We're going back and forth. We start communion, fellowship. See, when I start talking about holiness, here's where I find my holiness, in his body. When somebody starts talking about holiness, here's where I find my holiness, in his blood. Somebody starts talking about righteousness, here's where I find my righteousness, in his body. When somebody starts talking about oneness with God, here's where I find it. I find it right here, over here in this body. I take hold of him. John said, we have seen him, we've gazed upon him, and our hands have handled the word of life. For the life was manifested, and we have seen him, and declare unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. They stepped into a relationship with Christ Jesus, with the living God, with the eternal life, because Jesus defines what eternal life is, which is the life of God. So much so that they could manifest that life themselves. Father's made this available to everyone. He's left no one out. The Spirit of the Lord has been poured out upon all flesh, the empowerment that God has, the unlimited empowerment that he has been made available to whosoever will. Anyone who believes, these works shall you do in greater works. The call to come and receive the baptism of the Holy Ghost was first given on the Feast of Tabernacles, which is the one feast that will be kept throughout all eternity. Did you know that? Did you know that? There's some reasons for that I'm not going to talk about, but several reasons for that. But on that day, he talked to the general assembly of people, both proselytes and Jews and Gentiles, because it's such a grandiose feast. Josephus and others, historians at the time, said there was nothing like it upon the face of the earth. It was a great wonder and novelty. Such great joy and rejoicing. It rend the earth. Jesus cried out and said, if anybody's really thirsty, come to me. And I will give you to drink, and out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. This spake he of the Holy Ghost. The drink that I believe and the water that he's given is his body and his blood. This is the drink. Come and drink of the things of the Spirit. He is the rock, you see. Paul said he's the rock that followed us in the wilderness. And all you have to do is speak to the rock, and the water will come. Speak to the rock, Christ Jesus. The water of life. That wonderful glory of heaven that was purchased with his body and his blood for us to have. Fills us, overwhelms us from the first time and every time to be continually filled with the Spirit. And out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. The spake he of the Holy Ghost, which was not yet given, for he was not yet glorified. But Jesus, being glorified and having received the promise of the Father, poured forth that which you both see and hear as they were baptized in the Holy Ghost. As cloven tongues of fire came and set upon each one of them, and they began to speak with other tongues as the Holy Spirit gave them utterance, speaking through them. Communion. It's a happy time. It's a time of joy and rejoicing. It's a time of celebration. It's the time of the heave offering and the wave offering. It's the time to bring out and parade around the face bread that's before the Lord, the bread of his presence, and wave it before the Lord with shouts of triumph. Hallelujah. It's the hidden manna. It's the afikuman. The bread hid away that everybody searched for, you know, on Passover. The hidden bread. Where's the hidden bread? Seed for Elijah, he's coming. He's coming. And boy, watch out when he comes. After standing in the presence of the Lord for that long, he's so full of faith and power. He's so ready to preach, man, I'm telling you right now. And Enoch, of course, Enoch's been standing there for 5,000 years in his presence. The miracles and the signs and the wonders that they will do. When the 144,000 virtuous men from the 12 tribes of the children of Israel hand off the baton to them, watch out, man. It's going to come. It's going to be hell, literally, with 200 million demon horsemen that come up out of the pit to torment men. They can't get near Elijah and Enoch and anybody who's hanging around with them. Talk about being around the anointing, man. All hell's breaking loose. The wrath of God's being poured out, and the wrath of Satan's being poured out. But Elijah and Enoch got heaven on earth, surrounded by the glory, walking in the anointing. Nobody can touch them. Yes, Antichrist and the false prophet are going to be doing great signs and wonders, but they can't even compare to what's going on with Elijah and Enoch. And then the Lord at the end will allow their bodies, allow them to be overcome for a witness, for a testimony of things that we don't fully understand, but their bodies will be hung up, laid in the streets for 3 days, and the world will celebrate over the death of these two great prophets. That's how much the world hates God. God has shown us this. He's allowed sin to run its ruin. I want you to understand this. God has allowed sin to run its ruin, to run its course, so that he could show all men forever and all angels and all the hosts thereof that the smallest little act of disobedience that took place in the garden when Adam and Eve disobeyed God would ultimately grow and mature and end in a place where all men, not only do they not want to be under the rule of God, but they want to kill and destroy God. All sin will end there. It starts maybe harmless, simple, justifiable, logical, but it will end in you not even wanting God to exist. That is the story. That's the lesson of sin. That's how it's concluded. And that's the take-home message for all to see. Praise God for the liberty. You know Jesus? You know the eternal word kept everybody from Abel? Even in the midst of the sin, there was a means to keep them as his own. He could keep Abel. He could keep an Enoch. He could keep the various different ones down through their ages. Abraham, Job, the Abrahams, the others. He's always had a place. But there's always been few. As it was in the days of Noah, where it's where we're going, there was only 8 souls left. As it was in the days of Lot, of Sodom and Gomorrah, there was only Lot. There was only Lot, and they had to drag Lot out because they'd gotten so attached to the world because the family's hanging out. How can we leave the family? The family's here. Let's spend some time talking with them. Look, we got to destroy the city. You got to come. They laid hold on them and drug them out. And the iniquity, they were so vexed with the conversation of the wicked, the filthy conversation of the wicked. The scripture says, righteous Lot vexed his righteous soul sitting in the midst of that iniquity. And look what happened. Though he was God, though God's people, though he was God's covenant, he was so tainted by just even being around it. He gave birth to Moab. And amen. In a very terrible and such incestuous way. Look, the Lord knows what he's saying and he knows what he's doing. And knowing the severity of the Lord and the terror of the Lord, severity of the Lord and the terror of the Lord, we better understand. Knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men this. Knowing the terror of the Lord, this is what Paul says, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men that if one died for all, then all are dead, that we should henceforth no longer live unto ourselves. We got to get that part. But unto him who died and rose for us, and that's what we're doing right over here. We're testifying that that's what we're doing, and that we're stepped into that fellowship, and we've stepped into that covenant, and that that's what we want. Hallelujah. And that that's what he's given. And that if we want it, he's going to make sure it happened. And the message of Peter sounds out and needs to be sounded out in this day and time. He says, if the righteous are scarcely saved, where should the sinners stand in the day of judgment? I mean, we just need to get that. And I believe he says that in context of this. Because iniquity shall abound. As we approach that day, the love of many shall wax cold. And I believe that has a big part to play even before the time of the tribulation. I believe that those days have to be shortened even before the time of the tribulation. Because even there would be a possibility that even the very elect would be deceived. Deception has great power. Those who come under its influence never realize it. Deception has no reason. It has no logic. It has no insight. It has no understanding. There's only one place of safety. Get yourself baptized in the Holy Ghost, immersed in the Spirit of truth, because he will lead you and guide you in all truth. And that's the fellowship. That's the communion. Give yourself to living by the Word of God to say, okay, this is what you said, Father. I'm not going to change it. I'm not going to alter it. I'm not going to add to it. And I'm not going to take away from it. I'm going to let it be exactly what it is. And this is what you said to do. And so therefore, I'm going to do it. And I'm going to look to your strength and to your ability to be able to do it. And I know you're going to give me the strength. And I know you're going to give me the ability. Because I know that you're here and that you're living in me. And I can rely upon you. And no one puts their trust in you shall ever be disappointed. And you're going to have to do that, or you're going to be deceived. I believe that the Lord says, those who add to this book, the plagues of this book shall be added to them. And those who take away from this book, their names shall be taken out of the Lamb's book of life, because of this one reason. Because adding to it or taking from it causes you to be compromised with the lies of the enemy that will lead you into deception. But we still approach the word just as sacred, and hallelujah, we tremble at it with the haradim, with the really hard, huh? With the tremble. That means haradim means to tremble. Haradim means tremble, huh? The Lord says, heaven is my throne, the earth is my footstool. You're going to make a place for me to dwell. I'll tell you what, unto this man will I look, those who are broken and contrite and who tremble at my word, those who are haradim. I'm a trembler, I'm a shaker, I'm a Quaker from way back. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. Do you think this mic is going to work?
Jesus, help us. We're just, I'm believing for an entirely different sound system, a digital sound system. And we run things from up here, and there's a way to do it.
It makes it easier on everybody. So we're just going to lay hold on it, 2016. Anything that we need in terms of preaching the gospel and ministering the things of the Spirit, they're ours. We just got to go get them. Amen. That's you. Anything. Whatever you have need of, He's going to supply your need according to His riches and glory. The need that you have. How big is your need? How big is your vision? You see? Amen. Would you, this section would just come and people, this is a love feast. This is a love feast. This is a love feast, you see. This is a love feast of His great love for us that we get to reciprocate with in our love for one another. Love you. Thank you, Sigurd. Love you too, baby. Love you. Love you, Michael. Bless you. Love you, Deborah. Believing great things. Love you. How, you're doing good, eh? Yes. You're looking good. Love you, Stuart. Love you, Grace. Bless you. Love you, David. Bless you. Love you, Geneva. Bless you, dear. Hallelujah. Love you, Josh. Love you. Thank you, Lord, for your healing. Amen. Amen. You just healed. Love you. My dear brother, bless you, love you, bless you, love you, bless you, love you, bless you, love you too, bless you. Terry, here's a piece for you. Love you, hallelujah. Just keep the smile. Be dedicated to the smile the whole year. Love you. How you doing, buddy? That's good. Love you, Faith. Bless you. Love you, Nicole. Love you. Bless you. Love you, JJ. Bless you. Love you, dear. Bless you. Love you, man. Love you, sweetie. Live big for God. It's amazing places. You know, the Lord's God taking us to some amazing places. Do you realize where you're going to be in 100 years from now? Do you realize? Do you realize where you're going to be in 100 years from now? We are going to be doing some big stuff. Big stuff. And it just keeps getting bigger. I mean, by the time we get into the millennial reign of Christ, it is going to be unimaginable. And then by the time we get over into the realm of the eternal kingdom where God makes a new heaven, new earth, people, the beauty and the splendor of it, amazing. How are you doing?
Very well.
That's good. What is your name?
Richard.
Richard? Richard, you've accepted Jesus Christ in your life, right?
Yes.
Been made a new creature, right? Old things have passed away and everything's become new, right? Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Love you so much, Maya. Bless you. Love you so much, dear. Bless you. Father, thanks for the babies. Thank you, Jesus. Father, I just thank you for great wisdom and insight.
Come on.
Amen. I love you, dear. Yeah, this section is... I'm glad we don't have a sinner section anymore.
Love you, sweetie.
Annalyn, love you so much. Love you, dear. Love you, dear. Hallelujah. Chris, love you, man. Live big for God, man. Live big. Go big. Go big. I mean, really, go big or go home. And home's heaven, you know. Amen. Love you so much. Love you so much. Love you, dear. Bless you. Bless you. Yeah. Praise God. Bless you. Love you, dear. Bless you. Love you, dear. Bless you. Love you. Love you, dear. Bless you, man. Hallelujah. Caleb. Be Caleb, man. Come on. Come on. Lucas, live big for Jesus. Jordan, full of the Holy Ghost. No slowing down. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. That's all you got to do. If you're having problems with stuff, well, quit looking at it. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look unto the author and finisher. Love you so much, Jerry. Look unto the author and finisher of your faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down on the right hand with the majesty on high, expecting until his enemies be made his footstool. Love you so much, Jerry. Hallelujah. Christ the Tyrannite. Love you so much. Bless you. Bless you, Chris. Hey, buddy. How are you doing, man?
Good.
You taking care of everybody? He's reaching. Love you, sweetie. Bless you. Love you. Hey, sweet baby. How are you doing? You doing good? Grab a hold. Grab a hold. Hang on. Things are getting ready to get real good.
Hi, Mom.
Love you, sweetie. Love you, little buddy. You got the gloves on, man? Is it kind of cold in here? Lord, bless him, in Jesus' name. Love you, man. Love you, man of God. If you don't see yourself as a man of God, you need to get to see yourself as a man. Love you, sweetie. Woman of God. Bless you. Bless you. Joseph, you've been practicing.
Yes.
Okay, love you so much. Where has the fam been?
In the nursery.
Goodness gracious, you
we
guys been...
On the web.
You've been watching on the web. Yes. You need guys to be in the service.
Yes, amen.
I'll start carrying you around a bit.
Okay. Amen.
Thank you, Jesus, thank for the anointing Jesus. Of the Holy Ghost. Thank you for baby Anne.
Yes.
Anna. No, he hasn't got anything yet. I'll take it to him.
Okay, thanks.
I'll set it over here for you. God, who in sundry times and various different manners spoke unto the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he's made the heir of the world, by whom he created everything. And we thank you so much. Father, it's such an honor to us. We thank you so much. Hallelujah. What an honor to call you Lord. Lord Jesus. What a privilege to call you Master. Hallelujah. Father, we just thank you so much for all that you did for us when you saved us, when you redeemed us. To the death of your only begotten Son. Lord Jesus, thank you for your body. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, He could have called 12. He could have called 12 legions of angels. He could have called myriads and myriads of angels. He could have said no. But on the night that he was betrayed, he took the bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you, so that you could be one with me." Now I added that last part because that's where it took us. "This is my body, which is broken for you, so that you could be born again. This is my body, which is broken for you, so that sin and death may be broken off of you. This is my body, which is broken for you, so that you'll never spend a day in hell. This is my body, which is broken for you, so that you can step over into the realms of this holy place, the holies of holies that has been there separated from man, and until this day that I bring forth this offering unto the Father that will change the world and the universe forever. Take it, eat it," Jesus said. Hallelujah. This is the bread of healing. The bread of healing. When the woman from Syrophoenicia brought her demon-possessed daughter, and Jesus said, "It's not right that I should give the children's bread unto dogs." She said, "All I need is a crumb." This is the healing bread. It was the bread of affliction. The bread made in haste because the Lord has come to deliver us from the tyranny of darkness. But now it's the bread of liberty and celebration. Amen. 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 Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Ha ha. Woo! Ha ha ha. Father, thank you for the anointing. It causes our eyes to be able to see. Thank you for the spirit of wisdom and revelation that causes us to be able to have an understanding to know. The exceeding richness of your grace and of your love. And the inheritance that you brought us into. And the inheritance that you have in us. And the exceeding greatness of your power, this hour that you gave to us. You raised Jesus from the dead. When his mortal body received resurrection life. My resurrection in my life. Amazing. This fellowship results in us getting to live forever. Jesus said, "They who believe in me shall never see death." When I lay down to breathe out my last breath, I will pass from life to life. And we know that we've already passed from death to life because we know that we passed from death to life because we know that we passed from death to life because we love the brethren. Hallelujah. And after that they had eaten, he took the cup and he said, "This is the new covenant in my blood, which is given to you for the remission of sins, that your sins may be erased, removed, eliminated." All synonyms for this word, Greek word, "offices," remissed, forgiven, completely remitted, done away with. So that we can say, our garments are spotless, yea, whiter than snow. I've been washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The means by which it's all erased. It's all removed. And your sins and your iniquities, I will remember no more, says the Lord. I will remove them as far as the east is from the west. Wow. Wow. You know, when you get ready to drink this cup, I just want you to understand, this cup means this, that what God did through His great love and grace and mercy for us is He brought us into a union with Christ Jesus, the word that we live in Him and He lives in us, that we don't, there is no life outside of Him. We don't even exist outside of Him. We live in Him. So that all our righteousness comes from Him, all our holiness from Him, all our purity from Him, all our position, all our standing forever in the presence of the Lord in this communion. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Wow. No bitterness in that. No leaven in that. No poison in that. No alcohol in
it. Amen.
And no vinegar either. Just good, sweet, fresh. Tirsha, the fruit of the vine.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Pokana Saitiya. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. You know, we're just going to flow in the Holy Ghost like never before. We're going to live in the acceptance in the Beloved and the access that we have by the Spirit unto Him like never before. We're going to be preoccupied with greater volumes of Holy Ghost rivers flowing out of us. Amen. Pursuing the things of God with increase of God and increase in the anointing, increase in the things that He's provided for us like never before. It's what we're going to do. Amen.